So I'm gonna need this here so I can delete that. And what I'm gonna do, so for these data we're looking at, and primarily, you know, we're really describing the service function we do with EMG. But for this analysis, what we need is heat and mean activation during our activation windows. So that's why we just have the amplitude analysis and the timing analysis. You know, if we were doing like a fatigue protocol, we might get into, and I have some content for you on D2L about that, like a spectral analysis. You can actually measure and examine like fatigue conditions in that sense. But for this case, you know, we're not really doing like a sustained, continued isometric interaction or anything like that, but we want to do that. So we just have the amplitude analysis and the timing analysis here. And notice that's a little blip on the radar. So I'm gonna get rid of that. So I'm gonna expand this a little bit because, all right. So yeah, like we talked about last Thursday, we have a pretty clean. It's just zero until we get to that kind of box. So this is just a table representation of that kind of like box amplitude diagram for our on and off designation. So you can see that it starts here at 3.45 seconds roughly, and that it continues down until about 6.5 seconds. So that's our window for repetition in this instance. So we would be able to say, you know, if we wanted to calculate the mean and the peak, so we would go max there, and we would go average there, right? So we got our represented as a percent MVC, our max of 32% MVC, and our mean of 17% MVC during this repetition, right? Now keep in mind also, since we're not using the electric going on here, this is obviously concentric and eccentric phase altogether. So we would probably get some additional value information if we had kind of a segment data. But we can take this information, all right, and you know, like I said, I'm going to show you an example of something that's already been kind of completed. So this is from a study, like I said, we did 5 or 6 years ago. It's published in Support Biomechanics, and we're essentially just trying to determine if there are any differences in like kinetics and kinematics as well as activation patterns in like flywheel training devices. I don't know if you've seen these or if you've had experience with them. It's not really important, but essentially, since it's not an absolute like external load, we thought it'd be worthwhile to measure some of these things. And like I said, the specifics aren't really that important, but you can kind of see like a picture there of reaching the Pasco force plates on top of the device, the flywheel device. And you're kind of like tethered, like you have kind of a belt around your waist that goes in the system, and there's a like a pulley system that pulls against the weight that's generated from these like rotational plates there. The larger the blade, the more resistance the system creates. So this is kind of like an application that, you know, people have taken a look at for like astronauts and other applications with dealing with low gravity. So anyway, yeah, that was kind of the basic gist of it. Yeah, so that's the basic rundown of what we did. And you'll notice that we split it up into concentric and eccentric. So we did, I think, a set of 10 per condition, and we analyzed reps 2 through 9. So you can kind of see that there. Three different conditions, heavy, moderate, and light. And then you can see, in this case, we just did mean activation, right? So this study we did mean activation on the VM, the VL, and then the medial and the lateral gouge rod. And so you can see that represented here, right? You have our big table of all of our average activations per phase, per rep. So we have one value for rep to concentric, another value for rep to eccentric, and so on. And then we calculate ICCs and CVs from this, so you can kind of see the table here, eccentric, concentric, got our mean, standard deviation, CV calculated there. And then I actually utilized the Will Hawkins spreadsheet for reliability, which most of you should have. If you don't, someone might give it to you, or I'll give it to you if you ask me. So calculating ICC coefficients, you can kind of see what those look like there. So that's basically how we organize the data, okay? And then I also want to talk about sort of displaying the data so you can kind of see, in this instance, you have several conditions. In the analysis that we're about to do with your data, at least right now, it's kind of like introductory EMG lesson module that we've been doing. We won't have words or anything like that, but you just, again, I want to show you the kind of completion of a project. So once you get that EMG data, what are you going to do with it, right? So the first thing comes with exporting those analyses in Excel, organizing it in a way that makes sense to the study, and then ultimately like determining what type of visual display that you can show here. So you can see in this instance, so you can see A, B, C, D, these are our four muscles in the concentric, so mean activation. You can see the group mean and group standard deviation denoted there. In this study, I don't think any of the EMG variables were significant, but you can still see the Cohen's D that we reported here. Maybe as looking back at my former master's self, probably shouldn't have reported effect sizes there, but hey, who am I to say? But anyway, it doesn't really matter. But you can see, we're showing the pairwise differences, pairwise comparisons between all three conditions in each muscle in this case. All right, so if there was anything that was significant, we would probably need to know that they are really mastered or some other kind of symbol. So basically after that, talking about actual individual statistics around, not much really to say on that at this point because it's something that's going to be highly dependent on the study that you're doing. But for the most part, I want to make sure we're clear about this too. When we're talking about EMG, really any data that it's pretty common when we're discussing EMG to the difference between processing and analysis. So processing is everything we're doing in EMG works. So when we collect the raw data, pull it into there, and do a RMS or amplitude analysis or anything like that, that would be under what we would call processing the data, not analyzing the data. Even though those are kind of synonymous, analyzing would be the actual statistical treatment of it, and taking our data and graphing it, and running a statistical test, something like that. some meaningful numbers from this, right? And then the analysis, whether it comes into play. I think in this case, I can't remember off the top of my head, but I'm just looking at the data. We probably did a
So a reason that we collect non calves and biceps?
Yes, correct. Okay. Yeah, correct. Yeah. So realistically, what I'm going to ask you to do is after you've collected your data, you're going to have those four HDF files. And one, please make sure that they are clearly labeled with what the actual test was. Right? There was some like the automatic naming system that we use in the first one was switching things around. Some things were like set NBC on them, and they actually were the trial. Make sure those are clearly marked. All right. So what I'd like us all to do is one of you that wants to take ownership of this, create like a Dropbox or OneDrive or whatever, or you can use these days, and everyone should create their own like subfolder in there with your data in it. And everyone should analyze everyone's data. Okay, so you should be responsible yourself for analyzing all nine people's data. Right, so you're gonna have like nine participants in this analysis. So you have to go through the amplitude analysis, timing analysis for that. Combine all of those data together into a spreadsheet,
So each nine of us can choose our own like different muscle, non-caps, non-bicep? You said non-cap, non-bicep, right?
No. So everyone is doing the exact same thing.
Oh, caps and bicep again?
Everyone is doing, we're doing the exact same thing. And everyone needs to make sure that that was one of the things I was talking about last week, was make sure that you're completing the sessions with the same load, and make sure everyone is the same. So if we're going to do any sort of like a group analysis, then we need to make sure everything is as standardized as possible. And that comes down to electrode placements, that comes down to the protocols for the MPC, protocols for the actual like experiment, as well as like the, everything that goes into that. Same loads, same number of reps, same distance, all that stuff. We want to standardize as much as we can so we can determine, how does the class look? Do we, like, does any of the data look abnormal, right? Do we have like one or two people that are, showing outlier levels of muscle activation in this? Why do we think that is? Like, that's kind of the general idea.
So we start from the baseline, the collecting data?
Start from the, what do you mean baseline?
Do we collect the data again? For biceps and gastro?
Yeah. So that's so.
For this one only.
So yeah. So essentially, just kind of reiterating the data from the first collection that we did just wasn't that clean.
Right.
So I just wanted you to get some more repetitions due to that. So collecting the same data again, but paying a little bit closer attention. The first time was understandable. We're just trying to learn how to use the equipment. Now, okay, we got people. I think everyone in here can probably run this equipment and collect data on EMG without me there. Right now, I think everyone has shown that ability because you all did it already. And just paying a little bit closer attention to the quality and making sure that the data is going to be able to be analyzed on the group level.
We exactly did that for biceps, made sure, and it looked really clean and, four or five curves.
Yeah.
Then can we proceed to gastrocnemius?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right.
You can do, this is kind of like a work in your own pace, as long as you get it done in a reasonable, in the time that I'm giving you. But you can collect those data whenever you want, And you can do them all in the same session if you want as well. As far as doing things in the same session, different session, I'm not too worried about that.
Sorry for keep raising my hand up, but I think it would be important to make a unite procedure, because Josh, me, Francisco, and Caleb did the bicep curl with the same pace. So we increased the time interval from 15 to 30 seconds. And even after starting, we waited for 2 seconds to minimize the noise at the beginning. And then we started curling slow, and then we made sure we are stopping completely for 2 seconds after each curl, and that was falling perfectly within 30 seconds. So I think if we could all if you make us a unique unite procedure for both gastrocnemius and biceps, that would be helpful, because then we will analyze everyone's far under the same.
So that's basically what I'm asking you all to do, as a group, is to determine yourselves how to standardize that. I want to see what you guys can do after. I don't want to tell you what to do. I want to see what you do. So I want you all to communicate with each other.
So each group can use a different.
No, he wants all of us. He wants same. All of us just to get one together as an entire class.
Okay.
I think a good recommendation is the procedures that you four have already conducted. Summarize that and then share with the rest of us. That way it's saving you all work. Because you've already collected again.
Right. It looked really good for this time.
I'd love to see the procedures you all took. That way the remainder of the
that. Whenever I get done talking here, 10 minutes or so, then if you already collected data, did it make sense to do it the way you did it? Did somebody else do it in a better way, like create a cleaner data? If you have to collect data a third time, that's, you know, that maybe seems like a punishment or something like that. You don't, I guess you don't have to collect it a third time, but the idea, remember, you know, first year class, the way that we have structured this class is it's really up to you to get, like, I can show you how to use the equipment, but I can't show you how to get comfortable with the equipment. So more data collection isn't necessarily a bad thing. That's just gonna help you be better with the equipment. So I mean, if you have any questions, you want to run something by me, like I'm here for that. But I don't wanna like tell you, hey, this is what like exactly what I want you to do. I wanna see like how you want to think you got wrong yourselves a little bit, yeah.
Did you want just do it for the bicep?
Okay.
So I think what would be beneficial is if you all took bicep and standardized the process, and then what we could do, like me, Joel, Stephen, Hans, and Dylan, we could do the gastroc and summarize it and figure out a procedure. And that way it's like sharing the load a little bit and standardize the process. And then maybe one person volunteer to create the shared drug folder.
Yeah, I think for gastrocnemius, it is really important to stop like when you hit the 5 meter line, because I was keep moving and I saw others were keep moving too, and really screwed my data at the end. I could not really differentiate.
Right, okay, so the, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Because there's not inverse timing, like with the bicep curl, isn't it?
Right.
Except for the MBC, I forget how long. Is that like a 3 second?
Yeah.
Alright, so does anybody have questions about like organizing? A lot of it, what I will say about kind of like this whole type of deal is, yeah, you can see some of the raw data here that I poured into here. The idea is just to like, and from what I always see as like the person who's gonna be evaluating these is just something that's clean that makes sense that I can understand, right? I want to be able to see where you're like how you're collecting or how you're calculating things. I want to see like a central like a table, you know, something like this that shows me the information that you're calculating. It can be in like a whole, you can have like a whole separate tab that has like results in it, figures and stuff like that, whatever. I just want to make sure I can like understand what you're doing. Does anybody have a question about this organization?
Yeah, I think you have to deal with the point that the peak value is higher than the 100% of maximum concentration fraction, because although we measure again with more kilo pressure, high value is still about 100% of maximum concentration fraction.
Is that what everyone's or just isolated cases or?
No, almost again.
Yeah, I've noticed that one. So it's a little quick thing. So if you look at the Chinese, it looks a little better. That's the initial driver to what comes there.
Are you talking about bicep?
Do you have really big biceps? I guess, yes.
Mine was only 60-70%.
Yeah, I don't know, what if I was to take like an MPC in this kind of flexion, if that would
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, I mean, based on the, like, leg tension relationship with muscle, I would say, like, I wouldn't expect that to be the case. You know, I would expect it to be, you know, to be easy. Yeah, I think the reason why 90 degrees is chosen as a MVC angle is due to, like, we tend to see a higher activation there. So on the one hand, like, yeah, it's kind of like one of the drawbacks in MVC. I mean, you might just not